I'm Alisa, I'm one of the librarians here, and I'm also the liaison to science and math. So this is the second conversations on social issues event that we're having this quarter. I have some announcements to make before we get started. Our library hosts this series, as we see it, as an extension of our duty to promote the freedom of information and speech and the open exchange of ideas. So as we discuss today's topic, please be respectful of each other's opinions and perspectives. Over here, we have some books, some example resources that we have on today's topic that we have here in the library that you can check out. And we also have plenty of other resources like databases, articles, ebooks on these topics. If you need more help researching, come talk to a librarian. At the end of this session, I'll be handing out a quick survey. If you can fill out those and return it to me, they'll be giving us feedback on what you think about the series, what topics you'd like to see in the future, and how we can improve this series. I also invite you all, if you have a topic that you're very passionate about and would like to discuss, you're welcome to lead a cozy session in the future. Okay, so you can talk to me if you have an idea that you'd like to share. Today we have members from the Climate Disobedience Action Fund. We have Leonard up here. We have Michael who's hiding over there. And we also have Kara who will be helping us moderate today's discussion. And that is it. I will hand it over. Thank you.
All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Kara. I do some work with 350 Seattle, as well as some other different organizing groups around the city. I want to welcome you all here today. I also first want to recognize that we are on stolen Duwamish land, and I want to thank the Duwamish people for letting us be here in your space. So on October 11th, 2016, there were five valve turners in four different states that shut down five pipelines carrying tar sands oil from Canada to the United States. The date for the action was chosen as part of a solidarity with what was going on in Standing Rock. They had an indigenous call to action and prayer set of days. And so these activists came together, came up with a plan, and executed it on that day. They all knew that there would be legal consequences for this action, and yet they followed through anyway. At this point, all of them are facing felony charges with potential sentences of decades in prison, tens of thousands of dollars in legal fines and fees, and they are here today. A couple of them can share with you some of their experiences on that. They do all remain resolute in the idea that it was the right thing to do because any of the consequences of inaction were far more serious than the consequences they're facing for their action. So in addition to the five valve turners that are facing that, I also want to point out that some of the observers and documenters that were there with them also have been arrested, and some were facing legal situations. Lindsay Brazel, Dana Schlossberg, and Carl Davis have had their prosecution suspended in Washington State and North Dakota. They were all documenting the evidence or the situation that was happening. And Sam Jessup and Reed Ingalls were arrested and are still facing some charges. Another filmmaker, Steve Lipday, was covering the action in Minnesota, and 1 week after the action happened, he received misdemeanor charges in the mail. So they didn't charge him at the time, but they sent him charges in the mail. Those were for trespassing and aiding and abetting of trespassing. So Steve has created this wonderful short, it's about 7 minutes, this video. So we're going to watch that real quick and then get back to the thing.
Basically, this is Leonard. He's going to be past these two bikes here, kind of down this corner. There's a gate there and a gate there. That's what they're going to cut open. And they're going to do that at 8:30. The group, which calls themselves Climate Direct Action, includes five activists and four other supporters.
Between 7:25 and 7:30, Ken will call Kinder Morgan. At 7:30, he will close the valve.
fight to win. What do you guys think?
This is the only way we get their attention. This is the only way we can put a stop to it is by putting our own bodies on the line. Because all other avenues have been exhausted at this point. So for the sake of the children and the earth that we love, I'm ready to do this.
Somber and worried, but also serene. You know, at this point, we have to do something. I think this has a very good chance of being making an important impact. So, we're going to try.
Climate activists were arrested Tuesday for attempting to shut down all tar sands oil coming into the United States from Canada by manually turning off pipelines in Minnesota, Montana, North Dakota, and Washington State.
Extraction and burning of Canadian tar sands. For safety, I'm calling to inform you that when I hang up this phone, we are closing the valves. Please shut down these two pipelines now for safety and for our future.
Saboteurs for my action last Tuesday, closing a safety valve on the Trans Mountain pipeline and blocking the flow of Canadian tar sands oil from Alberta to the Anacortes refineries. There is no question about what I did. I live streamed it, and you can see the video at www.shutitdowntoday. The only question is whether what I did was an appropriate and practical response to what President Obama recently described as the terrifying climate conditions.
young person on this planet, I'm going to be living through this century, and any children I might have will also be living through these consequences.
If people are not acting as though there's an emergency, people don't believe that there's an emergency. And so for me, this is all about acting consistent with the threat that I'm seeing.
He credits his awakening to social justice and climate change issues to a 2007 workshop from Joanna Macy in her book, Active Hope. In 2012, he was a co-founder of the Corvallis chapter of 350.org, and he has also had previous direct action experience. One of the things he helped with was supporting Native American nations and blocking the movement of tar sands extraction equipment in Oregon. That happened in 2013. There was a lockdown situation so they could prevent equipment from moving, and also the two-day rail blockade of the crude oil trains at Anacortes that happened last May 2016 as part of the Break Free. It was actually a global week of actions, and the Pacific Northwest version was Anacortes. Leonard was there. So Leonard has beliefs in Unitarian Universalist principles, including the inherent worth and dignity of every person, and respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. And these seem to help guide his commitment to the moral necessity of participating in nonviolent direct actions in order to protect life on this planet. And Michael Foster, over here, organizes with a lot of climate justice groups. You may have heard of Our Children's Trust, a recent landmark climate victory with children over the state of Washington for air and water. That is a really interesting thing that happened, and those kids were pretty brave and amazing for taking on the state, and I can help you with that. He's also an organizing founder of the Pacific Northwest chapter of a global organization called Plant for the Planet. It was actually started by a child in Germany as part of a school project, and they are trying to plant 1 million trees?
1 trillion.
1 trillion trees.
It's 1 million.
There were too many zeros for me to know what that meant. so a lot of trees. It's a really great project. He's also helped with the Shell No campaign against Arctic drilling and helped defeat the what I've heard someone refer to as the zombie Keystone XL pipeline, because it was defeated and now it has risen again for us to defeat again. So he's there for that. And Michael's here to help generate action that wakes people up to the reality of what we're doing and how life as we know it on this planet could change. He's changed a lot of things in his personal life. He's retrofitted a Geo Metro to all electric, eating a vegetarian vegan diet, and retrofitting his house for energy efficiency. He also works a lot with children, you know, with our Children's Trust, and teaching climate science and things like that to not just think about climate justice, but to inspire action in ways to reduce the extraction of oil, coal, and gas. I'm sure they have many other wonderful things to say about what they've done. So I'll ask a few questions, just to kind of get things going, and then we'll have a question and answer session for you all to ask them questions that you might have. So first, a question that I have is that it seems pretty apparent based on this video and other things you've done that both of you believe that civil disobedience is an effective strategy for working towards change and getting things accomplished. So in that, how can we further mobilize people to either commit or support acts of civil disobedience to solve the multitude of problems we are facing in this society?
So we definitely are working on that. When we planned this action, we didn't picture it as a single day of work. We anticipated about a year of effort, beginning with the action, reaching out at talks like this, and working towards each of our court cases, jury trials in four different states, bringing what's called the necessity defense. And in a nutshell, that is sometimes called the lesser harm defense. If you're walking by a neighbor's house and you look in, you see it's on fire, you see his kids are there, you're not going to walk by. You're not going to worry about breaking and entering to rescue those kids. And we see that we're in really the same situation, a much worse situation. We've got a threat to billions of children on this planet. I've got 5 kids and 2 grandkids, and that figures very heavily in me wanting to do whatever I can to protect them.
Yeah, and as far as how to mobilize more people, I think first thing you do is you elect a narcissistic fascist. And that really does a lot to get people up off the sofa.
It is kind of the silver lining we're seeing.
Yeah.
Glad there's one.
And then you take action over and over and over, and hopefully some of those actions will get noticed by the media, because you know if a pipeline gets shut off in North Dakota and it isn't posted on Facebook, did it really happen? So you have to do both of those things. Do the action and tell people about it. And, you know, in a system where everything is busted, I shouldn't be cynical. Somebody name a system in our country that's working, because I know there is one. I'm an optimist.
Community colleges?
Community colleges are still working. Yeah.
Under severe budget cuts.
And the word community taken out of the name.
But. Right. No community. Too much community. We don't want that. Yeah. Okay. So, so I think that's what Seattle is here for, is to mobilize people. We're leading the way on divestment and other projects. We've got the greatest concentration of wealth and homelessness that you need to inspire people to do incredible, important things. Like Kara's doing, maybe we can ask her some questions.
Yeah, actually, I would. Could you talk about the Pledge of Resistance?
That's in the program.
Okay.
It's coming. Okay.
But there is definitely great things to be said about that.
Definitely join with others. 350 Seattle is a particularly amazing group. Michael can talk more about it than I can. I'm involved with 350 Corvallis and 350 Eugene down in Oregon.
So I guess I'm making all these jokes, but the point is that we are way too blank comfortable to be out in the streets, you know, lighting fires and throwing bricks. And when we do, I'm not to offend any anarchists here, but it looks ridiculous. Right, because we are well off. The system is working the way it's supposed to, and so why are we complaining? So I think it is up to us to emphasize and throw focus on what's really busted about our system, and it is an emergency. We don't have any more time. We're supposed to be below 350 parts per million CO2. That's where that name comes from. We haven't been there since I was in college. We're at 410 parts per million CO2 today. Life, sustainable, you know, planet, life as we know it, civilization goes on once we get back below 350 somewhere. That's the upper limit. And it's rising faster now than it ever has. So that's what the kids are suing for in court against the federal government and here in Washington against the state. And they've won four important court victories defining their constitutional rights to the essential, Washington's essential resources, air and water, which they will require to grow to adulthood safely from the judge. These are not rights that were invented. These are rights that are found in the state constitution. You know, like, did black people have civil rights before the civil rights movement? Yes. Yes, the civil rights were always there. We just didn't recognize them. So, in my mind, if our kids, and in Washington they have been spelled out, if our kids have these rights, you and I are violating. Every time we turn the ignition, we're violating their rights. That's a criminal act. So, what are we doing with that? Because we're robbing their future, we're stealing the balance that the planet requires to keep them alive. So, just letting people know this is an emergency. We need to do this, the tree planting thing. There's a little proverb. When is the best time to plant a tree? 20 years ago, because you need a tree. The next best time is today. Because you need a tree. You don't want a tree.
I'm not claiming or feeling that direct action and civil disobedience is the only work that's needed. I look at it as an avenue to remove the very powerful blocking efforts of the fossil fuel and moneyed interests that are getting in the way of the changes that we need in our economy and in our culture and in the way that we live our lives. It's very difficult to do what Michael's describing, actually. If you're a parent, you've got to get your kids to school, you can't afford housing that's near your job. There's so many obstacles to the changes that we need. We've known and criminally the fossil fuel companies and government have known for decades that we need to make these changes. If we would have started even 5 or 10 years ago, the transition could have been much more gradual than it needs to be today. We need to begin getting off of the fossil fuels and transitioning to alternative energy sources. We need to revamp the transportation system. We need to localize food delivery. We need to get off fossil fuels as the driver for industrial agriculture and get back to methods that actually keep the carbon in the soil. All of that work is really important, and it's work that people are doing, but they're being blocked. And so that's why we're advocating for direct action and civil disobedience, people actually getting out in the way of business as usual, removing their consent for the harm that the corporations and government are doing.
Yeah, we can actually just open it up to questions. I think
y'all
have better questions than me. Yes.
Well, you both touched upon kind of climate activism. That's kind of the whole ethos of what's going on here. And so at one of our campuses recently, a group put some tickets on car windshields that looked very official. And basically was saying that you're robbing your thieves of the future. Saying, you know, you need to, there's no fine, you're basically taking from your children by driving your car. I thought that was a really cool disruption to someone's everyday life to remind them that by driving that car, they're emitting fossil fuels and that is having an impact on the environment and so on and so forth. Our administration did not think it was as cute. And, you know, there were some folks that were disturbed or felt threatened by that, I feel like. And so I think my question is, do we need to challenge each other? Or do we need to challenge the systems that make it seem the norm? Or do we need to do both?
Oh, it's always both. Whatever the question is, it's always about. Seriously.
Yeah.
We are way past one or the other.
Do we alienize them by doing that, though? And do they feel like they now have to stand their ground even further?
And do we make people uncomfortable when we go out in the streets and we stop traffic? Yeah, we do. We polarize people, and people are already more polarized on climate than they are on abortion or gun control.
Yeah.
Right?
What a bizarre place to be at.
So, yes, we polarize people. But until we get movement, until we get fossil fuels staying in the ground, no more extraction, we're cutting back on the existing use, and we're, you know, planting one new tree for every three trees alive on Earth. Until we're doing that, we're not doing enough, or we're not doing it right. So polarize people, right? Force them to feel that discomfort, because that's what that is, right? I might decide no. These people are absolutely wrong. Turning off those pipelines is dangerous, right? Those pipelines are dangerous. Duh! Those pipelines are dangerous. That's why we turn them off, right? So yes, constantly refocusing people's attention on the issue any way we can. If somebody comes up with the magic silver bullet, the formula that is so irresistible, all of us like throw our car keys in the ocean, then we're good.
We'd be polluting the ocean.
But that thing hasn't happened. Like, I want to throw my car keys in the ocean, but for some reason, Americans, we are not throwing our car keys in the ocean. It's like we got our hand in a monkey trap, you know, and we just will not turn loose of the keys. We can't free ourselves somehow from that trap.
And I love that action. And I think that when you just put something before somebody, yeah, we are going to make people uncomfortable, but putting it before them is not like, you know, their ability, their right or whatever to continue to drive their car has not been taken away. So I think that's very, very constructive. I just wanted to comment, I love the film. I thought it was really well done. And I saw a film once before, I don't know if you want to add something to this film. I saw a film a couple years ago, I can't remember the name of it, and it showed the tar sands in the devastation up in Canada, and it was a film about, it interviewed people in the oil industry, oh, we've had great success, we never, you know, damage anything, blah, 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 and then it interviewed the people on the other side. That has just had a lasting impression on me. I mean, I realize the issue goes way beyond, you know, what the devastation right there is, all the other things you've mentioned, but seeing what happened there, this gorgeous, beautiful, pristine forest, and how it is, there's nothing, you don't even know that a forest was there before. It is such devastation. If you go Google, everybody.
You can
see
it from space.
Yeah. It's unbelievable what the tar sands has done. Nobody in their right mind would want to live anywhere near there. It is so horrible. And so, thank you.
Yeah, I mean, the introduction to you, Leonard, that she said that you were influenced by Joanna Macy. Could you talk a little bit more about her, talk some about Joanna Macy and that inspiration?
Sure. So she helped me actually face the problem. Like so many of us, I spent most of my life looking away from what was happening, that a part of me knew that things were horribly wrong, but I wasn't willing to face it. And so Joanna Macy in her workshops deals with the spiral. She starts with gratitude for all that we have and all that we love in this world, and really helps the folks in the workshop get in touch with that. But then she goes through grief and through looking with new eyes and then going forth, and it's really the grief. I mean, if you really face, there's several exercises like having a group of four people where one person represents the future, the other the past, the other the current, and then the other that is kind of a neutral person that facilitates. And don't want to spend too much time on it, but the exercises really help you face as a person, as a being from the future, as you're, you know, I was thinking of my own kids and grandkids and talking to them and then telling me, you know, and you start with a scenario that if we keep going the way we are, what is that future going to be like for our kids and grandkids? And I won't go on and on, I can, about Joanna Macy. She's in her 80s and she's still radiant and still teaching a really powerful message, helping people to actually face what's going on and taking energy from that rather than being demoralized and immobilized.
Her workshops are on the web, so people can go and
Yeah, the work that reconnects, if you Google that. She's going to be in Portland coming up fairly soon, yeah.
There's a group doing her work, and typically they'll do like one workshop a quarter, and they're free, and you know, it's just a tiny little group. But it's a very powerful afternoon to get in touch with this. And how many of you saw the movie Back to the Future?
Yes.
Yeah, that is like the comic version of a Joanna Macy workshop. Right? When Michael J. Fox is playing the guitar and he starts to disappear, you know, and he's gotta get his mom and dad to meet each other and like each other, and they've gotta make that connection, and he's starting to become transparent, right? That's the comic version. The workshop really kind of invites you to step outside of time and to talk with beings who aren't here yet and who are going to ask questions of you living today. Like, you know, what gave you the courage to do what you did to solve this? And you get to answer. You don't know what it is you did yet, because we haven't solved this yet. But this future being is here, and the only way they can be here is if we solve it. So I get to answer that question. What gave me the courage? How did I know what to do? So it's wonderful stuff.
I've got to say that I took one for workshops 30 years ago, so if anyone needs another endorsement, please look at me.
I feel, you know, what you did is really powerful and really inspiring, and thank you for doing that. I saw, you know, this action being covered in Democracy Now! Last year, and, you know, it's not surprising that you have been charged, you know, with such, you know, big, you know, time in jail and, you know, such big, heavy felonies. I was wondering if you could talk about, you know, what charges have been put against you, and secondly, you know, if there was anybody, you know, in the political spectrum, you know, who came out and helped you, or like, you know, just said that, you know, these charges are baseless, you know, they should not be put on people, you know, who are willing to protect climate changes. If there was anybody, you know, maybe the whole country, you know, who came out and like talked, you know,
nobody did that. Our politicians are not going to do that. Our climate change governor didn't do that. Ken was tried here in Washington State. No politician said anything nice about Ken. That's not an okay thing to do if you're a politician. But he will be retried in a few weeks, May 22nd,
in Mount Vernon.
He will be retried because he got a hung jury.
Mm-hmm.
He showed a video of himself doing the thing that he took. He provided the video. They watched it twice. And 12 jurors could not find him guilty of trespass or sabotage. No, I'm sorry, what was it, burglary or sabotage? It was they dropped the trespass. They were so scared they weren't going to get a conviction. They dropped all these other charges except for two, burglary and sabotage. And Ken said, you know, when I read the definition of the crime of sabotage, that's exactly what I did. The jury didn't find him guilty because what he did was necessary to prevent this greater harm.
And they denied him the right to bring the necessity defense. He was not allowed to bring any expert witnesses about the threat that we see, about the power of civil disobedience to bring about social change, to address that threat. He was only able to talk about his state of mind, his motivation for doing the action. The prosecutor objected many times, and the attorney redirected Ken to talk about how he felt, why he was compelled to do this, and that was allowed. He was allowed in his own defense to talk about why he did what he did. And he talked about sea level rise in Skagit County that's going to basically flood the tulip fields that are a source of community pride there. He talked about the rise in carbon, the rise in temperature, what's going to happen right there in Skagit County. And at least two of those jurors couldn't convict him, felt that what he did was necessary.
Same thing with the Breakthrough Rail blockade. On Friday, six people out of 52 who were charged, six people went to trial, and on Friday got a hung jury because what they did was prevent this greater harm. So, yeah.
What about the matter of charges against the videographers? It seems to me that's a blatant constitutional issue also applying to people who record the police.
Yeah, First Amendment rights there, yeah. Shocking, really, very shocking. Like we saw in Standing Rock as well.
My prosecutor was bragging when I was arraigned after spending 2 days in jail. Yeah, it's not every day you get a call from a senator. In a county, North Dakota, it's like almost Canada. And he was so proud that the senator had called him about this, bringing these charges. So they just wanted to throw the book at people.
Yeah. And I forgot to respond to your question about the charges. So in Montana, I'm charged with criminal trespass, which is a misdemeanor, and criminal mischief, which is a felony. And the maximum prison term for me, actually the lightest of all of us, is 10 years. But since I don't have a previous felony conviction, none of us do, it's very likely that we won't have any more than a year or two. It's still that uncertainty, though when we go before the jury, our future is in the hands of that jury in deciding whether we're guilty or not, and then the judge is responsible for handing down the sentence.
Martin Luther King wrote from Birmingham jail one of 30 times when he was arrested. When a person challenges an unjust law and is willing to face the punishment, it arouses the conscience of the community and shows ultimate respect for the law. He was writing to white ministers who wanted him to shut up, right, and follow the rules. And he said, you know, we will always struggle as long as there are people who love order more than justice. We did not create this tension. We merely bring it to the surface. And that's what good civil disobedience, good direct action does, is it paints a picture and tells a story that forces people to confront that cognitive dissonance. You know, the system is working the way it's supposed to, and it's pretty messed up.
It's really important that the direct action, civil disobedience, be nonviolent. There's a large academic study. The lead researcher is a woman and author by the name of Erica Chenoweth, and she studied instances around the world where different means were used for overthrowing harmful situations, dictators, and all kinds of situations. And it was nonviolent direct action that was most effective. In fact, if there was 3.5% of the population that was actively participating in the civil resistance, it was nearly always successful. If there was 5%, it was always successful. In those instances where violent means were used, there were instances of success, but when they examined afterward what happened in those situations, more often than not, in fact, the majority of the time, there was a return to the harm that was being done. It was just being done under a new regime or a new system.
I think that what surprised me most about this action was when I learned how few people it took to shut down all the Tar Sands coming into the United States. And I remember that Angry Levins did a report on brittle power in the Defense Department in the 80s, where he talked about these very centralized energy systems. And it seemed like even if climate change were not an issue, it would still be a concern that our energy system was so vulnerable to the action of a few people.
There was a White House briefing the day after the action where that vulnerability was brought up. And I forget how many millions of miles of pipeline.
2.2 million miles of oil pipelines in the USA, most in the world, and they are required by law. They must have these shutoff valves all along in case there's an accident. And you know, we were just some old, you know, nonviolent white hippie folks.
Speak for yourself.
who were you know, there to make a point and stop the poison for a few hours. But when it was called in, you saw Jay calling in the action to the companies. They reported it to the local sheriffs as a terrorist attack. And in my case, in North Dakota, I learned later that the pipeline company called in this terrorist attack to the sheriffs to get the sheriffs out there right away. And then they waited another 20, 25 minutes before they pushed the shutoff button. So now I want you to put yourself in that remote pumping station. And you're calling the sheriff because there's a terrorist attack on, you know, the Keystone Pipeline, 590,000 barrels of dilbit, toxic, cancer-laden chemicals, highly volatile, traveling at 150 degrees through this 30-inch pipeline across the continent, and you've got a terrorist attack on your pipeline, and you don't push the shutoff button for 25 minutes. What are you waiting for?
The pipeline delays,
right? Something. It doesn't make any sense.
It makes sense if the pipeline bursts and then it gets blamed on a terrorist.
Yeah, well, maybe that. I don't go that far. I think it's just about the money. Maybe they were hoping it was a prank and they could keep the oil moving.
They do everything they can, yeah, to keep those profits flowing. Yeah, that's a part that I noticed.
So,
right,
we have time for one more question.
So I'm just hearing, you know, the most cynical part of me thinks that you all just wouldn't be sitting here, right? You wouldn't be allowed to be talking to us, you know, that you're essentially wiped off the planet, you know, by big oil. But I'm hearing.
I'm safe. I've got friends keeping an eye on me all the time.
Uh-huh.
I mean, no matter where I go or what I do, I am secure in my homeland. Thanks, guys.
That's your advice.
I guess I'm saying, so I've heard, like, you know, politicians would never step up. You know, the oil companies waited to shut. It's, I'm wondering, with everyone you interact with, the sheriffs and the hung juries and sort of the examples of cynicism and people showing up at this time, the misunderstanding where we're at with climate change and our culture and people, sort of, what did you see, the good or the bad, whatever strikes you?
So what you're saying just brings up something I forgot to mention earlier, and that's, as an old white person in this culture, I have a special obligation and responsibility to use that privilege. You know, if I was a person of color, if my economic status was different, everything from being perhaps shot on site when law enforcement showed up, to being mistreated in a violent way by the arresting officers, to being disrespected, disregarded in terms of my rights of due process in court, all of those things, there's a huge difference that we're not all equal before the law. And since I have this privilege, not just because my generation is responsible for a large part of the problem, not just because I have a moral responsibility to my community and a responsibility of love to my children and grandchildren, but because of that privilege, I have more responsibility to and more ability to respond to it.
And for me, it's about the kids. I work with these kids all the time. And I go and I talk, give climate talks like Al Gore in the schools, you know. There's gonna be an Al Gore training for 3 days at the end of June in Bellevue. So it's free training, check out Climate Reality Project. But like when I after I did this action, I was really nervous about going into the schools and kind of being out as a disobedient, accused felon, and whether I would be invited back. And like I had some emails with this one principal who was like, you know, well, as long as you're talking about like Martin Luther King, you know, it is Black History Month, I think we can get away with that. And then the teacher showed the kids this video before I got there, the day before. And when I came into the cafeteria, there were these posters like butcher paper, welcome climate hero. And like it was like Bruce Springsteen just walked into the cafeteria. And I was like, but that's the response that we typically get from at least a handful of students everywhere we go, whatever age group. I think the younger people definitely get it. I think that this action has inspired a lot of people. I know that I've had people look at me and say, you know, I'm thinking about my life differently because of this action. Okay, great. That's why we did it.
So that is a good segue into like, where do we go from here?
Yeah.
What do we all do? So you mentioned earlier the 350 Seattle's Pledge of Resistance. I will read the pledge to you because as many times as I've said it, I don't have it memorized. Because the urgency of the climate crisis is not being adequately addressed at the national level, I pledge to engage in acts of peaceful civil disobedience to help stop fossil fuel projects and fight for climate justice. Pretty simple. So what that means is, there's a whole pledge of resistance team, and if you sign the pledge, you can either say that you are willing to commit acts of nonviolent civil disobedience and do some of that on the ground activity, or you would support those risking arrest. There's many support roles. You know, as I mentioned, you don't have to be arrested and become a felon.
We need a few people outside jail.
Yeah, you need to help with jail support. You need to be there when they get out to give them snacks and cigarettes if they choose, whatever. Like, that's really helpful. We need people to go to their trials. Ken Ward's trial is coming up. If you happen to be in Montana or any of the other places when they have trial, I'm sure they'd appreciate you being there. And all of that information can be found, actually, for that bit on the Shut It Down dot today website. If you sign the pledge cards, and I have to say that I don't actually have the pledge cards because of a campaign I was involved in that yesterday resulted in some things happening that my pledge cards are locked in a building I no longer have access to. However, I do have a notebook and copies of pledge cards with people who signed it, their info written out so you can see what it looks like. And you can sign the pledge by signing my notebook, and we can get you on that list. Some of the things that go into that are there, like, different trainings and workshops leading up to when we activate the pledge. Sunday, there is a nonviolent direct action training hosted by 350 Seattle and the Neighborhood Action Coalition. It is from noon to 5. You do need to register because they only have so many spaces. But it's free, donations are very much appreciated because it's hard to put on. But that will give you a lot of context for nonviolent direct action, a lot of information on tactics and things to do. They're very important things to go to. And then occasionally there's like peacekeeper training, medic trainings, like basic safety, or like I just did a 20-hour street medic training for that side of actions. So there's a lot of things you can do, a lot of ways to get involved, a lot of support that can happen. There's also, for these climate activists, there is a phone number. If you want updates, if you pull out your phones or a piece of paper, this will give you information about the court dates and shut it down and everything that's happening if you do want to support them. And that phone number, you would text the word join to 508-318-5147. And I can say that again, text the word join to 508-318-5147. And that will give you updates about these specific wonderful people who've done a great thing, I think, in bringing attention to the climate situation. So, any final questions? Any questions about the pledge? I mentioned that.
I assume the pledge is like you get a call or an email being like, can you be at this? Can you come support these people today or next weekend? And if you can do it.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, it's sort of, you're not held to it. We're not going to find your house and say, you said you would help us and drag you out. maybe we will.
That's a good idea, though. We haven't tried that yet.
I just thought of it.
Yeah.
It does ask, I didn't even put the part about asking for your city and state, so I just want your email and phone number. Yeah, and then there are, we send out once a month just a reminder of things upcoming or our blog. We have a blog about different activities, different things about climate justice, people who've written about their experience in direct action and different things. And then, of course, as the pledge is activated, you might get more emails telling you what's going to happen, upcoming like action planning meetings if the pledge gets activated, and what information you'll need to know to help in whatever way you can. Cool. Thank you all for coming, and I will have my notebook over here.